Feroze and I have been doing these shows around the country, and we've sort of covered quite a lot of ground. But it's interesting because today he's focusing quite a lot in terms of estate planning, and obviously it is one thing that you are seeing through your experiences as sort of sorely lacking, I would say, in certain places, as well as, I guess, the kind of opportunities that people already have, whether it's through taxation itself. So it's very valuable to see this kind of emphasis going forward. There are a few things I want to emphasize in this discussion today, Feroze, and I want to start by talking about this whole idea of the importance of a balance sheet. When you talk of a balance sheet or writing down all investments on a single sheet of paper, say I'm your average HNI client and I happen to have portfolios across other institutes as well. You know, really, honestly speak, how does one really capture their full wealth? And also, what are some of the common sort of setbacks you've seen people have? Perhaps it was their perception of realty, perhaps it was their idea of, you know, what sort of investments they should be making. So how does this whole true picture come through, and how does that eventually then reflect on asset allocation?
Correct. So firstly, if you draw your balance sheet, it has to be across advisors, it has to be across assets, it has to be every rupee which you are not using only is meant for growth. Okay, this is a at least one weekend's task. So we have formats which we share with a client which helps them remember which items which would have got missed out.
Right.
So you give them all the possible 12, 13, 14 items which generally other clients miss out, where they bring them all together. So that becomes a cue for a person to fill it. Of course, after filling it, the person says, yeah, why will I disclose all my wealth to you? Right? Because giving an opinion on money management, nobody's opinion should be taken unless he sees the entire jigsaw puzzle. If somebody says, I have 1 crore, what to do? This is insufficient data for me to give you any advice. I don't know whether this 1 crore is with 9 crores of real estate, or is this 1 crore, which is the only 1 crore you have. How much is debt? How much is equity? How much is real estate? I don't know. How much is gold? So anybody who gives an advice with just this piece of information, he is in a hurry to take your 1 crore. You might show him the 10 crores and still give him the 1 crore. It's okay. Right? But not seeing a report and giving medicine, not that my profession is as noble as a doctor's. I'm not trying to imply that.
Yeah.
But if I have to give any advice, I need insufficient data to give advice.
Okay.
Now, if I have to give tax advice, I need to know whether you have a private equity fund where I can apply Section 48 and reduce your tax on mutual funds.
Okay.
If I don't know whether you have a PE fund, now PE funds did badly, but they can help you save tax on a debt fund. But how do I give that advice without looking at the balance sheet?
Okay.
So you show the balance sheet to a person who is your confidant, whom you think you can show it to, right? And you are bound to get a good advice. Then implement the advice for 50 lakhs with him. That's okay. Whoever it is, Anand, Rathi or whoever, but without showing balance sheet, that's point two I'm making. Point three is people have this amazing or this fear of disclosing balance sheet. But in my opinion, I tell the client, you disclose your balance sheet, I'll disclose my balance sheet to you, right? Then we are even, right? Or you get a non-disclosure agreement signed by me. Or anyway, give me in percentage. I don't want amounts, right? You don't have to say 10 crores. Now you can say in percentage, I have 11% here. Nobody needs actual amounts. At least give in percentage. Then the person doesn't even know what's the actual wealth you're speaking about. But share that piece of information. And people who are not asking for this information itself means that they are not giving you good advice. Because you can't give good advice, in my opinion.
Okay.
Any doctor who is in a hurry to put me under the knife and say I need a bypass surgery without seeing the CD, I'll be very scared.
So the importance of disclosure is probably healthier for the client than it is for anyone else. Let's talk about the second aspect of this. Two main concerns, and I'm talking about even my experience, forget media, I'm talking about as a wealth manager in the past, have always been the sort of right attitude that HNI should have towards property investments, okay, and also what expectations around liquidity should really be all about. Okay, so what are the two sort of reflections you have when it comes to these things.
So one interesting observation is when I've seen quite a few balance sheets, because you've seen a lot of balance sheets, a large portion of that is in real estate in India. Okay, that's the reality. Globally, it is 16%. In India, it is 62%. Okay, maybe we know real estate better than the rest of the globe. Maybe, maybe not. But that's one startling differentiation.
Okay.
Point one. Point two, we have been negative on real estate for the last 5 years, and we've been very vocal about it. Of course, coming from a wealth manager, they think that he has to say negative on real estate. Not necessarily, because most wealth management outfits have started a real estate division to cater to it. But we have been very negative on real estate. Hyderabad over the last 5-6 months has done reasonably well in real estate. And you are the biggest aberration in the country. That's what, I don't know whether you get that sense or not, but this is what I read and this is what I've heard. And Stata says that last 3-4 months there has been a reasonable pickup in Hyderabad's real estate. I would say I would consider it fortunate to exit. Why? Because of 2-3 reasons. One is there are two phases of life. One is growth, the other is consolidation. In the phase of consolidation, right, I had a target to my balance sheet. Once I reached that target, then I wanted all my money liquid on a click of a button. And real estate doesn't help me do that. Right? So if you are in the phase of growing your money, then real estate still has some role to play. In consolidation, there is a lesser role to play because you can't access the money.
Okay.
So wealth has to be accessible, not touch and felt. People get very excited because I can open the door, go inside, sit in my apartment. But if you have 5 apartments, you can't stay everywhere. Right? They get very happy with tangibility. Tangibility is now defined. Now, the new definition of tangibility by Oxford is tangibility of an asset is access to its value. If I say my house is 7 crores, if I can't access the value of that money, that is not tangible. Right? So tangibility is now defined as nothing but access to value is tangibility. If I see a mutual fund, for example, at 3 crores, I know that I can access it in 3 days. That's tangibility, is the new definition. Now, what definition do we want to go with? That's your choice, but I'm just disclosing. So, point one, Hyderabad is lucky that it's showing an uptake. But in our opinion, Hyderabad will also create immense amount of supply because everybody is going laterally upwards.
Okay.
Nobody wants to go flat. Now, people are constructing 5 stories, 10 stories, 20 stories of towers. So they are creating supply from thin air. That's why Mumbai prices are so subdued, because everybody who has 2 acres of land, he wants to plan a 70-story building. Places where 10 families were living or 20 families were living, now 1,000 people can live. So that is 980 extra families can live in the same land, right? And when infrastructure becomes better, people will spread out. This is another thing. Our countries, Mumbai had very, I can speak about Mumbai because I've done a lot of research there. Mumbai's prices, real estate prices have been very high for long periods of time. Now they're coming into control because there was no infrastructure. There were no bridges. People had to stay in one place. Now they're making 40 kilometer bridge. It means that in another 30 minutes, I will be on the other side of the bridge.
Correct.
When you choke the city, the prices in the central areas are very high.
Yeah.
As infrastructure happens, as metros gets built, as bridges get built, people spread out. And then the cost of property in the central areas come down. If Worli, Bandra Worli Sea Link was not there, Nariman Point wouldn't have been suffering now. Nariman Point is 60% down in price from peak.
60% Why? Down from peak?
Commercial.
Wow. Okay.
Right? Commercial is down 60% from its peak. It was 1,10,000 square feet. Deal is done at 42,000 square feet, 42,000. Why? Because Bandra Worli Sea Link was there. Otherwise, nobody could have, you would have been choking the city in the south side. You wouldn't have made BKCs of the world.
Sure.
Right? So infrastructure will improve in this country. And if infrastructure improves, people will spread out. Builders will create supply from thin air. And supply is going to be immense. So I would, in a consolidation phase, I would sell my real estate and keep my monies liquid, ideally.
Okay, ideally. It's a scary idea though, because you know, there's an entire concept, there's an idea about real estate, brick and mortar and everything else. But I see your point in terms of how this actually works out on the ground. Tell me, what sort of a role is mathematics really playing in terms of portfolio construction? And also, how much of what we consider risk is actual risk? Because the idea of risk itself, as we have discussed earlier, is something that is perhaps not fully understood. And risk is also something that is an opportunity. So tell me a little bit more about the kind of mathematics that's being used. How much of this is stuff that really can just be done with some more finesse, in a sense? What are the responsibilities an excellent wealth manager has when it comes to these issues?
Correct. So mathematics, unfortunately, is not being used in the stream of mathematics as much as desired.
Okay.
There are mathematics is the, now I made a large statement. Now to substantiate that statement, in most of the wealth management reports, you only see return measured 10%, 12%, 8%, 13%, whatever be the return. Do you see risk measurements on your reports? Risk is only in English. High, medium, low. When one side of the coin is in percentage, is the other risk should be measured or should it be in English? In treasury management, when you're managing corporate money of large quantums, risk is measured in five different variables. Every day it gets measured. I have three smart traders, IIT, Cambridge, one guy is IIM Ahmedabad. Before I finish the day, I would have a report which will say, what are my risk measures? What is the risk I took today? Right? And on the other hand, years go by, decades go by, risk has only been spoken about, not measured. That's how little mathematics has got into us. So what am I trying to say is, don't use five measures, use simple one measure at least to measure risk. Risk is best measured out of the five, if I have to choose one, which sounds complex but easy to measure, is something called standard deviation.
Yeah.
Very simple, sounds more bhari barkam, but we have this, finance has had this very bad habit of naming them very, very complex. They should have given simple names. Standard deviation. See, if I was a banker and I gave you a fixed deposit, if I said 8, you will get exactly 8. No deviation. Correct? If a bank tells you I'll give you 8 fixed deposit, standard State Bank of India, it'll give you 8.
Yeah.
That's a constant. But if I said 15, is it a constant? No. If I said 15, it can be 13 also, 17 also. Correct? It is not a constant. You need to keep that in mind. If it is not a constant, you need to see how much variation is possible. That will tell you the risk. Your expectation is 15. The deviation from the expectation possible is called, the swing from the expectation is possible is called standard deviation.
Okay.
In our strategy, we like to keep the standard deviation at 8%. Return should be at 15. Standard deviation should be at 8. I will tell you what it implies, what it means. 15 return, 8 standard deviation means plus 8, minus 8, swing. It helps you define the swing, right? They say enough, this person is very moody. He has swings of mood. Like that, if 15 is your expected return, 8 is your standard deviation, that means you have defined one range now, 7, 15 minus 8, 7, 15 plus 8, 23. This is called first range. This is called first range. Then you have to also get your second range. Is it very difficult? It's simple. No? 15 plus 8, 23, 15 minus 8, 7. This is called range number 1.
Okay.
Range number 2, you need to at least check two ranges. Range number 2 is 15 minus 8, one more minus 8. 15 plus 8, plus 8. So the second range is minus 1 to 31. Now you have two ranges, 7 to 23, minus 1 to 31.
Okay.
You will be 98% of the times in this range. This is what it means. Simple. Out of 100 years of investing, 2 years you will cross this range also. 98% of the chances is that you will stay in this range, minus 1 to 31. Now I have to ask this to the client, sir, are you okay that in a very bad situation, you will lose 1% of your capital also? If he says not okay, then I have to devise a new strategy, because 8 standard deviation is not acceptable to that man or lady. So point one, measure risk is something we can do. We have not measured it so far. We can spend the next 20 years without measuring it. But measuring it is a good idea, because that's the only thing you manage. Return you can only pray for. Risk is the only thing which you can manage, right? That's why it's called expected return and risk management. You open a finance book, it will say expected return. Matlab, you can only pray for that return. Expect. Risk is always suffixed with a word called management. So measure it. Standard deviation is a good measure. Standard deviation does what? Standard deviation helps you find out a range. Okay, if your expectation is 15, if 8 is the standard deviation, now you know range 1 is 23 to 7. Range 2 is 31 to minus 1. Okay? And statistics tells you, you will be 70% of the times, you will be in range 1. 28% of the times, you will be in range 2. 2% of the times, you can even cross that range and go out. Right? So, now Mr. Rathi has told me that I want 12% return. I want 12% return with 3 standard deviation. That is the job given to me. But client only says, I want 12% return. He doesn't even complete the sentence. He never says that I want 12% return. I want 10% return with what standard deviation? So he has said 12 with 3 standard deviation. So if we did this math again, 12 plus 3 minus 3. Okay, 15 and 9 is range 1. Range 2 is 12 plus 3 plus 3. 18.
Okay.
Range 2 is 12 minus 3 minus 3. So 6 to 15. 6 to 15 is his second range. So he says, I am very happy with this risk. In the worst situation, you will give me 6% return.
Okay.
Mostly. So please measure that risk. So this is one mathematics you have to do. There are other 3-4 layers of mathematics which we need to add to our portfolios. If we add more mathematics, decision will not be done by human beings. Math is better at decision making, because human beings are putlas of emotions. It becomes very difficult for us to take rational decisions, but mathematics helps us do that.
Interestingly, you have actually segued right into what I wanted to talk to you about, which was this whole idea of mutual fund selection methodology. Please explain to me how it's actually done. Also, lately there has been something called a broker code change. Can you just throw some light on both these issues? Because it's interesting for us to understand what's really happening within the industry, and also within that, how is this entire selection methodology working? How does it work? How do you decide? What are the kind of implications it has for the people who perhaps may be your clients or perhaps want to be your clients as well?
So out of all the 20 products, I was interviewing somebody day before yesterday. He says, my company sells 22 products. I said, why do you need 22 products? If the client has a simple requirement of generating 13-15%, do you need complex stuff? We had done a lot of research to ban several products. So only 2 products and 1 or 2 risk management techniques which we use, and I'll describe them to you. And in my money, there is no third product, except 2 products and risk management techniques.
Okay.
And my portfolio is a reasonable size portfolio, and my returns are good quality. So point one is, why am I saying this? Fatima, like you asked this question, what are those 2 products? Mutual funds and structure product. Mathematically can be proved that everything else is irrelevant, and with lot of data can be proved that everything else is relevant. I'll be experimenting with my money if I do the third thing.
Yeah.
Apart from this, you only read risk management techniques. And I'll give you a very contemporary risk management technique, which is very, very important before the election. Okay, so mutual fund becomes very important. So the question which you've asked, how do you select a mutual fund, becomes that much important. Because if you're doing only two products, you better go right in them.
Yeah.
Right? So there are 400 odd equity mutual funds. 400 में से मुझे चुनने हैं पांच, right? 10 में से पांच चुनना आसान है, 400 में से पांच चुनना है तो बड़ी मेहनत करनी पड़ेगी. Because गलत फंड हाथ में आ गया तो तबाही मच जाएगी, अच्छा फंड आ गया तो it'll actually make a lot of money. So there are three steps we follow to choose a mutual fund.
Okay.
For the last 7 years we've been following this method. It has been not the best method, I can't say that. Of course it has helped me deliver 2-3% extra return per annum vis-a-vis even the better funds.
Okay.
What is that method? Step one, use a concept which is mathematical, of course sounds more complex than it is. It's called regression. This is nothing. Why am I using this word? So that a person can do secondary homework in 1-1.5 hours, how much information download should we give? So regression is called statistical astrology.
Statistical astrology.
Okay, like we believe in astrology.
Isn't that a sort of a contradiction of sorts, statistics and astrology? But anyway, you can start.
Statistical, very good, very yeah. good question. Statistical astrology means data of the past okay. has some indications of the future. Regression is a subject which helps you draw a trend. Okay, so regression is it's again won a Nobel Prize. So I would say, why would I discover anything? Itni kitabon mein itne acche concept hain, usko istemal karunga. Hazaron crore manage kar rahe hain. Then you need to do justice to it and use these good concepts. So step one, use regression. Step two, there are 140 human beings managing these 400 funds, almost 3 per head. Out of those 140 human beings, forget the name of the fund, check each human being's decision taking capability. So this is something which has helped us immensely, and my friends and my clients and myself, is to check these 140 people, are they taking good decisions? So we took all the 100 decisions they have taken in the past. So you get 14,000 decisions. You have softwares to cull out their decision. If he has taken 80 correct decisions, 20 wrong decisions, then he is a good fund manager. This is called right to wrong ratio. If Mr. Rathi has to see whether I am a good CEO or not a good CEO, he will say, Feroze took 10 decisions for my company, 8 went wrong here. Sack him. So decision making capability helps you understand the future potential of the fund manager's capability to take decisions. So we found out there are only 21 fund managers who have taken 80 good decisions and 20 wrong ones.
Wow.
The rest of them have taken 60 correct decisions. 60 correct decision is not good, because you can 50-50 is anyways law of probability. Ya to fir aadmi sahi jayega ya to fir galat jayega. 80 sahi nirne liye, if he has taken 80 right decisions, he can't be a dumb guy. He is by design choosing making better decisions. So that's the second filter. Third is again more futuristic than past, because mutual funds always have this disclaimer, past performance is not an indication of the future.
And they say it very quickly.
Very quickly, yeah, of course. So people might not have noticed.
Exactly.
It's the quickest part of the advertisement. There is, if that is the problem, then there has to be some method, na? What we did was, I think it is logical, you are the best judge. Mutual fund is nothing but a basket of stocks. Whenever you buy a stock, when I recommend a stock to a friend also, he says, kya target hai iska yaar, 200 ka hai, 400 hoga kya? He asks this question. Nobody will just buy that stock if I recommended a stock, that is. So every stock has a target. We go to the best analyst of the country, find out the target of each stock. Once you know the target of all the stocks, now you know the target of the basket. So every mutual fund, we find out the target NAV of the mutual fund. And if the gap is large, that means it has a larger packed potential. What am I saying? Every stock, will you buy a stock? If I told you buy some stock, will the obvious question be, what is the target price? People will definitely ask this question before they buy the stock. But do you ask that question when you buy a mutual fund? What is the target NAV? No, we just buy it.
Yeah.
Right? If stocks can have a target, will not a basket of stocks have a target? But is Anand Rathi's opinion going to be correct on all stocks? No. But why should I go with my opinion? If you buy a Bloomberg software,
yeah,
which is 30-40 lakhs a year, the best analyst of the country is rated there, the best analyst. I will take his opinion. Why will I take my opinion? Because I can't know all the 1,000 stocks, 2,000 stocks. So you take the Bloomberg estimate of each stock, find out the target NAV of the mutual fund. Jahan gap zyada likhti hai, usme potential zyada hai. Wo fund kharidna chahiye. So if, in these three steps, if you did it, will you make, will you get the best funds? The answer is no. Will you get better funds? You going wrong dramatically will definitely be ruled out.
Okay.
Right? So that's the selection methodology.
So that's something to be sort of really looked at and contoured very well. I want to understand a little bit more, as I brought up earlier, this whole broker code change. What does it really mean? Why is it important for us to talk about?
See, what happens is, see, now people say, "Yaar, I liked your mutual fund selection." Then people go and check whether TV Pace ne 6 saal pehle kya bola tha. Achhi scheme boli thi ki nahi. Then they say, "Haan, yaar, he's recommended good scheme." They come and ask, should, now if I like your methodology, how do I align my portfolio to your methodology?
Okay.
One is to say, give me cash, sell all your mutual funds and give me cash. That's unfair because there is going to be exit load, there is going to be taxation. Hmm. Right? Then I say, you can change me as your advisor. Then there is no cost implication to them. I don't get commission for the transfer, but I can't be selfish everywhere. So broker code changes are nothing but aligning somebody's existing portfolio to your selection methodology without a cost implication to him or her, without a benefit to me. Commissions don't come on broker code change. From 2010, SEBI said no commissions on broker code change. But if I forget that, then I would not want anybody to sell and bring cash, because now there is taxation also. No? So that's what broker code change is all about. Okay. So if somebody likes the selection methodology, they should come not with cash, but they should change broker, because if I have to only look at my commission, then it should come with cash.
Okay.
But if I skip that as my objective and agenda, then that's the thing. One more thing which you said was risk.
Yeah.
How do you manage risk? Let me tell you one method of managing risk. There's a hoo-allah of election aega, right? So what will happen? Right? Some people say, no, yaar, after election I'll invest. Somebody says, yaar, mere paise lage hue hain, main kya karun? So, firstly, last four general elections, if you invested 6 months before general election, sold after general election 6 months later, the minimum return you would have made in that 1 year is 17%. Dar zyada hai, data kuch aur keh raha hai. Minimum return in the last 20 years of four general elections, 1 year investment is minimum is 17, maximum is 55. But when I speak to people, they are more scared than what the data is saying, point one. Point two is, you can sail through election covering all your downsides. Let's assume a Khichdi government comes, as they colloquially call it. Okay, Mayawati becomes the prime minister of this country. And then we become half on Nifty. What if I told you, you can go through the speed breaker of investing life, which comes every 5 years, with a cost of 1.5%. If you spent 1.5%, you can keep all the upsides and cover all your downsides.
Okay.
How to do that is a separate story. But if Nifty goes to, like, last 6 days, like I told you, everything changed in last 15 days. Everybody on TV was saying negative, negative, negative. Today, everybody says positive, positive, positive. Right? It changes so dramatically that, so if it goes to 12,000, matlab, if it goes up in 2 months, 15%, is it not wise to spend 1.5% and being very secure? I think it is very wise to spend that money, because it's always better in the investing world to have money in your pocket than in the bushes, right? Agar 15% ki return 2 mahine mein aa gayi, to usme se ded kharcha karke 13.5 ko jeb mein rakho, karega kaise koi? Is that what you want to do?
Yeah, that's what we're talking about options. Are you basically talking about a derivative strategy, or what is it?
See, all I'm saying is, for the lack of time, I will restrict this.
Yeah.
But see, if you have to manage risk, you need to have all the finance armory.
Yeah.
You can't go with a bag which does not have all your weapons.
Tools, yeah.
Right? And tools. So there are armory. How can you do it? You can buy a call option and put money on Biaj and get this outcome. So I will not explain it completely, but if you asked a representative of ours, he'll explain it to you maybe. So on a one-on-one discussion.
Okay. So interesting, because as you said, that statistic that you're talking about in terms of elections and returns, and this whole sort of counter paranoia that comes in around elections, which kind of leads to investor paralysis, is perhaps something that, if you look at the maths, is unfounded. Of course, one can find out a little bit more about options and the kind of methodology you use. But tell me, you know, how should we be looking at volatility as a concept in the markets? And what is the sort of general understanding you feel HNIs have when it comes to understanding volatility or events, event-based changes, I guess, or perceptions when it comes to their hard-earned money sort of multiplying as much as you would?
Correct. So when you're looking at volatility, volatility is nothing but standard deviation. Standard deviation and volatility are synonyms. Point one, okay. The good thing about risk volatility is the higher the period, lower is the risk. That is clear. 1 year volatility is very high, 3 years is lower, 10 years is very low. What I was telling you, 8 standard deviation was 3 year volatility. In the same strategy for 10 years, that volatility is only 4. So with time, risk reduces. But one risk which you should not take is never take liquidity risk. Liquidity risk you should never take, in my opinion. Anything which binds you on the chair and you can't get up and go, in a dynamic world, you should always be able to change your decision and reverse your decision. People, why am I giving this word of caution? Because I have been a wealth management client myself for Anand Rathi and elsewhere as well, wherever I've worked in the past. For the last 7-8 years I've been here. Whenever there is illiquidity, there is high commission. If I lock you in for 8 years, I will get 9% commission. Right? If you are free to go, the person whose product it is, he will not give me commission, na? Because you don't know that 3 months later, chala jayega yaar, client. So, jahan bhi lock-in market hota hai, jaise insurance policies, 10-year lock-in, 35% commission. Liquid fund, 3 days you can go away. For 1 crore in 1 year, commission will be 1,800 rupees. You understand? If it is insurance policy, I will make 35 lakh rupees. That's the disparity. So, illiquidity is the riskiest thing to do. Now, I was reading on the newspapers and I got some journalist called for an article on REIT funds, real estate investment trusts, illiquid. Okay, it might just be that you will have to dump your stock 20% lower than your price. Please, in wealth management, I at least wrote my principles down that I will, for any amount of return, I will not lock in my monies. I should be able to reverse, take a U-turn on that road. That's one risk. Illiquidity risk is so much in English that people don't consider that as a big risk. Okay. That's my word of caution. I have seen a lot of people getting penalized. Like one AAA rated company went bankrupt last September. Okay, AAA rated company went bankrupt overnight.
Biggest story, yeah.
You could have bought a fixed maturity plan, which is a locked-in product, in which that company's bonds were there. People are selling it at 10% discount. If the same instrument was open-ended, 2% is the loss. If it is an FMP, 10% is the loss. This 8% extra is because of illiquidity.
Okay.
So illiquidity risk, liquidity risk, बहुत बड़ी risk होती है. और एडवाइजर वो आपको समझाए बगैर ये प्रोडक्ट देता है क्योंकि उसमें कमीशन ज्यादा मिलती है.
ओके, सो दैट्स अ वार्निंग साइन, रेड फ्लैग दैट वन शुड रियली बी लुकिंग एट. एंड इट्स इंटरेस्टिंग दैट दिस इज हैपनिंग अक्रॉस द बोर्ड. आई मीन इट्स नॉट जस्ट बेसिक रिटेल इन्वेस्टर्स. आई वांट टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस होल आइडिया ऑफ हेजिंग अ पोर्टफोलियो. And also, I mean, I know that you yourself, of course, have been instrumental in terms of really creating awareness as well as perhaps teaching people how to leverage structured products. Okay.
Correct.
So number one, let's talk about what hedging a portfolio should really be about. And also what role can a structured product, or what is the sort of most significant things structured products can provide their clients with? And just because you have a plan, does it mean that you don't need a structured product? Or if you have a structured product, maybe it means that you don't have a plan. I mean, how is the whole dynamic working out when it comes to managing funds?
So the choice of these two products out of the laundry list of 20 is on the basis of a role to be played in different market cycles by each of these.
Okay.
Mutual fund is plan A, structure product is plan B. The advisors have another problem, that's my problem as well. that we always create portfolios assuming that I will go correct only. It's not going to happen. I will go wrong. When I go wrong, my client should still make some money somewhere else. So you have to have a plan A and a plan B. So question to ask ourselves is our portfolio designed with a backup plan? When you go to restaurants, you have a backup plan. Yaar. My friend is saying, either masala library mein seat nahi milega, table nahi milega, toh idhar jayenge. For small things, we have plan Bs. Do your portfolios have a plan B? And if no, what should be the attribute of the plan B which can complement and bring down risk? So structured products are plan B. Structured product gives you mediocre return, not super normal return, mediocre or little better than mediocre return in bad markets.
Mediocre return in bad markets is not such a bad thing.
Mediocre returns in bad markets.
Okay.
Now if I give you the converse of the theorem, then you will say no, it's a bad thing.
Okay.
Okay, now I'll tell you what are the demerits as well. So in a bad market, you got mediocre returns, you're happy. But in good market, getting mediocre returns is going to create some displeasure.
Of course.
Right? But you have to be prepared for it, because if good markets happen, mutual fund will do its job. When bad market happens, mutual fund will look like a dumb idea, but structured product will look like a super idea.
Yeah.
Right? Now, I'm speaking to clients, they're saying, yeah, in my bad year, like 2018, I made 16%. When mutual fund made 1% or minus 5%. Why don't you make your entire product structure product portfolio? That is not a good thing to do, because in 2014, structure product was looking like a dumb idea. Mutual funds were looking superstar. Both of them will look like opposites. At one point in time, you will hate one of them for sure. At least dislike one of them. So you should not go all in one of them. So both have a role. Structure product tells you if you made 5% on Nifty, you will make 15% or 16% post-tax. Nifty growing by 5% is a very large likelihood.
Okay.
If Nifty goes up 5%, the product gives you 15 post-tax, nothing more. Even if Nifty triples, you will only get 15. That's the flaw,
okay,
or the flip side. But then I also have enough chips on mutual funds laid that if the market does very well, this guy will give me 25-30% return and I will not be completely out of the game. That's the relevance of structure.
Throughout our conversation, it seems to me that there's a lot less mystery, really, or there's far less reason for fear that really exists, because you can figure this out mathematically. There are certain responsibilities the fund manager has to have. There are regulations that also seem to be working in tandem with the whole industry developing. If I was to ask you, before we're going to close our discussion, and of course then I'll open it up to the audience, what do you think is the most important strategy HNIs should be looking at right now? You know, you talked about elections, this, that, the other, but what do you think is something that you feel is very often being missed in terms of management of their wealth at the moment? I mean, you've talked about estate planning, you've talked about the importance of taxation, you've talked about the mathematics of it. Is there something else you feel is not being sort of done enough? Is there something that your firm is actually also really focusing on? Because I know that you've really, this mantra of, you know, save, invest, prosper, simplification, it's something that you've been very much vocal about. But is there something you really think H&I should sort of sit up and hear at this juncture?
See, I think H&I's two things. One is H&I's should use, or at least check whether your advisor is capable of using the tools available.
Yeah.
One. And be clear of what you're looking in your CFO, right? When I see people live with three advisors for 10 years, I say, 10 saal ke interview karne ke baad ek CFO chuno na, hazaron crore ka CFO ek hota hai company mein, but ek client ke 4 crore 5 log manage kar rahe hai. Why is it a risk to you? I'll tell you. Okay, point one I'm making is use the finance tools. To substantiate that point, I'll tell you what is the biggest question which people ask me as, Feroze, this is all past, yeah. Tell me future. Right? Because these returns are past.
Yeah.
So in finance, which I use in treasury for the last 12 years, there is a simulator which simulates the next 100 years. Can you believe it? It's called the Monte Carlo simulator.
Wow.
Why am I giving you these names? Is that you Google and see, there's one Mr. Monte Carlo created a simulator which helps me simulate Nifty for the next 100 years and tell me what are the different outcomes possible. Right? So I use that in Treasury. Because Mr. Rathi will not be satisfied with the last 20 years risk measurement. He will say, if new things get discovered in the next 100 years, how will my portfolio behave? So I'm just telling you, point one is tools are there. The biggest and the best portfolio management theory in this world. Right? I just finished one. I was interviewing a candidate. He says, I've been doing wealth management for 13 years. So I asked him, which is the wealth management principle theory which won a Nobel Prize? Only one theory won a Nobel Prize. If I am an orthopedician, will I not check who won a Nobel Prize in my subject? There is a person called Markowitz who won a Nobel Prize for a theory, which is such a beautiful theory. A large portion of my money and the strategy which we develop is on Markowitz. So point is, please use those tools, or at least urge the person to use the tools, because there's so much which has water has flown and we have not used it. That's one advice. Second is, be clear of what you're looking in an advisor. Once you know what you're looking for, and in 5-7 years, choose one person.
Okay.
Need not be Anand Rathi, but choose one person, because what happens is, I have seen a 5 crore customer.
Yeah.
He has distributed his money across 4 people, 1 crore approximately. So that 5 crore portfolio is behaving like 1 crore for each of them.
Mm.
Okay, and 1 crore may, it is very difficult for me to give ethical advice.
Ethical advice.
Why, I'll tell you. Because I am giving a private banker. Okay. A private banker will meet you 10 times, 12 times, 6 times in a year. In 1 crore, I will earn 1 lakh rupees. I'm telling you my commissions. 1% is what we end up earning on the monies we manage. 1 lakh rupee, I will pay 33% tax, 66,000 rupees. I'll pay that guy, he will 6 times. He can manage only 30 customers. So he's maximum going to earn 20 lakh rupees for the company and himself. It is not possible to give ethical advice. When you spread your money too thin, everybody is waiting to give you that one product which can make them 20 lakhs in one shot, done and dusted.
Wow.
Right? So what happens is, when you spread it too thin, you're a small customer where the person cannot give you ethical advice. So make a choice of one CFO after at least 5 years of interacting with 3-4 people.
Okay.
And how, what do you look for? You look for capability, trust and commitment. If you look for these three, capability, commitment and trust. Capability is measurable. Like, I have an audit report of all Anand Rathi customers' return for the last 5 years. Audit report by one of the big four.
Okay.
If the number comes good, it is 15.5% with 9% standard deviation. So capability is measurable in our business, but you should ask for that. You should ask for, what is your CEO's return? What is Feroze's return? You can measure it, and that's audited. We audited by one of the big folks. I'm not supposed to say the name. So capability is measurable. Trust is also measurable. Trust, they think, cannot be measured. You should see whether the advisor invests exactly like you. He is buying PMS for you, but buying structure product for somebody else.
Yeah.
I should invest like my client. This is the most important thing. Industry doesn't do this. I have interviewed 400 people to hire 100 people. The first question I ask is, what does your dad buy? What does your client buy? There is hardly any intersection, right? So if you can get the statement of your advisor or his dad or his CEO, then see whether there is intersection. People will give you bahanas, saying, sir, aapki risk alag hai, meri risk alag hai, yaar. Isiliye maine alag cheez kharidi hai.
Hmm.
Risk is managed by percentage. If you are high risk taker, you put 80. percent of your money. I'll put 20, but we will do the same thing in different proportions. You can't do two separate things. Commitment is, if he has 100 customers and you are one of them, then he will not be committed to you. Is he available to you?
Sure.
If he is capable, trustworthy, but not available, then it's useless. So these are the three things. So this is one thing which I see a risk to people.
Uh-huh.
They think not all eggs in one basket and run three advisors, five
advisors.
So they
advisors. End up damaging them, their portfolio. Yes. Very quickly, I'm going to ask the last question. I just had to, because I know you have a flight to catch as well, and I want to give the audience an opportunity to interact with you. How often should HNIs be reviewing their portfolio?
reviewing the portfolio, you should not do it very high frequency.
Yeah.
But if you're doing private banking, we tell our people that you should meet the customer once a month.
Okay.
And you should also meet the same person who is going to be the next in line. Like I am deputy CEO because my CEO is 64 years old and he's a very wise man, my guru, and I think that he should be there for the next 20 years. So point one is, how often should you review? Full-fledged review once a year. Monitoring once in a month, not just with the client, but you should ask the client who is the next in line.
Okay.
And force that person to sit through these meetings, 12 meetings in a year, so that they have some idea if there is an eventuality, and the eventuality will be there. We don't know when. So that's the review. Sorry.
All right. I just want to thank Feroze for really having patiently answered all my questions. And I always have tons of them for him, no matter which city we're sitting in. But thank you for that. And I want to thank this wonderful audience for listening so patiently and carefully. We are now going to open this up to the audience. May I just request that you keep your questions short and you also introduce yourself when you ask them. And we will hopefully have about 10 minutes of this interaction.
I'm Bhagwan Komadi, founder of a quantum computing startup. You mentioned about Monte Carlo methods.
Monte Carlo
simulation for simulating Nifty and other index for 100 years. I am founder of a quantum computing startup. Do you see quantum Monte Carlo methods playing an important role in planning the simulation or investment decision making?
Monte Carlo simulation, of course, I have been using for long periods of time. It tells you historical probabilities might not be relied upon. Right, it says that on a 3-year basis, Nifty can be negative 8% of the probability. 8% sambhavna hai ki 3 saal baad bhi Nifty niche ho sakti hai. Right, but Monte Carlo simulation says 13% probability. So yeah, there is a role to play, but in treasury management, there is a role to play currently. Wealth management, it is not being used. That's our aspiration. That's what we've been endeavoring to do. That's the answer, sir.
Observation about your scenario of 4 elections and what happened in the stock market. I think we are in different conditions right now. Real estate is different now, and investment in real estate is not doing that well because obviously there are restrictions, and then Modi government is coming with a lot of other things. So the money that is stashed away probably has to come out and look for something, and that's what is probably happening. So probably not a good indicator of what happened in the last 4 elections versus this election. That's one as an observation. But what I wanted to ask you is, are you showing any returns on a basis of a performance? I mean, do you have performance-based return fund strategies? Or is it just collecting 1% or whatever and then, yeah, showing whatever that is? Because then you're just going into mutual funds. If you sieve through most of those mutual funds, the top performers will be no more than 50 stocks or 75 stocks. And this can be done, you know, even without a mutual fund. You can gradually invest and you should be able to do that and put on some option strategies on the downside. Simple. So the point is, how would you do it, performance-based returns? Is there a company that is doing this? And do people have to be really in stocks? Can they not be in derivatives itself? Why bother about stocks then?
Wonderful. So that's a lot of comments. Point one, when I told you the last 4 years of four general elections outputs, of course, the fifth one could be different. The sixth one could be even different. That's why 55 and 17 itself is different. Both. There will be difference. Like 3 months back, we put a note out. Anybody who's a client might have seen it, at least in media we put that note, saying that general tendency is a run-up before the election. And that's what you're seeing. We put out this note at 10,200. Right? And today we are at 11,450. The note could have gone absolutely wrong. But past cannot be completely ignored. You can't be scared of something which made you the maximum money. The most profitable years cannot be, you can't be scared of. You can be neutral to it. So people are on the other extreme. So there are several things which need to be told, but I'm just encapsulating it in the lack of time, is why I'm telling you. So point one is, of course, there will be a huge transformation in the country's kept aside black economy. And it's happening. Of course, people say still there is a lot of cash, especially in Hyderabad. I meet a people and they say, there's cash. Of course, there's cash.
There's also cash.
There is a lot of cash. Yeah. But you have to compare it from how it was to where it is. It will take 20 years to clean the mess. But it is gradually reduced for sure, and there are indicators and there are measurements to it as well. So the third point is mutual fund kyun loom hai, right? I generally don't insist that you buy mutual funds from me or the ones. I generally tell the client to check that 6 years back, whatever mutual fund I recommended, if that beats your strategy or your mutual funds, then come to me. If you are lesser, by taking my advice, then I would never. So your capability of managing money could be different than somebody else's capability, right? So how do I check it? If you are poorer, if you took my advice 6 years back, it's there in public domain. If you are richer, then you should follow my advice, right? What happens is the best mutual fund and the worst mutual fund every year have a 28% difference. How much? 28% difference. All of them have the same name, equity mutual fund, right? So your statement could be true for a few of them, might be completely untrue for a few of them. It's about which few. If you look at last 10 years, the best and the worst equity mutual funds, both are called equity mutual funds, have a difference of 28% per annum. Forget in different companies, in the same company, SBI. SBI Focused Equity, which is one fund. SBI Mid Cap, which is another fund. I had given a 2 year back, my mutual fund team told me to tell. So I would not claim credit to it. I have an 18-member mutual fund team, so I should not be saying that I said it. Sell SBI Midcap, go to SBI Focused Equity. Same company, difference is 23% return. Mm. So it is not about why should I go to mutual fund. Which mutual fund will decide? Which mutual fund are you buying will decide whether mutual funds actually deserved the 2% fee which they charge you. Out of the 2%, 1% comes back to me, to be honest with you. So I don't charge the client. It indirectly comes to me, but I'm being transparent about it, that even if you bought a mutual fund through me, be rest assured that I'm getting 1% indirectly, but it's going from your pocket. That's what I meant. I don't charge 1% directly. Indirectly, it comes to me. Okay? But yeah, you should know about it, that it comes to me, is why I was mentioning that. Now comes to performance fee. We don't do performance fee on a large scale basis. With one of my closest clients, he said, you do profit share, you do loss share. I have done an agreement of a loss share also with that client. Okay, so so will I do that as a productized profit share model? I don't think you deserve to pay me profits, because there is a lot of performance is an external factor in certain cases on relative performance. So no, the answer is no. But am I prepared to do it on a case-to-case basis? The answer is yes. Have I done it in the past? Yes. With one client. I share a loss, I share his profit. Capital is not mine.